talk to me anymore. All they do is avoid me or ignore me.
Buck, I've watched you interact with the team for the past 4 weeks, and it seems no matter how hard they try to do what you ask, it's never enough. Do you enjoy your relationship with the team?
No, I don't.
Are you willing to try and experiment for 1 week?
Yeah, of course. What do you have in mind?
Well, at that invitation, Jillian shared another nugget of leadership from her grandfather. She explained that his first experience with management was also rough. His mentor was a German immigrant who carried a big stick, but a soft voice. The big stick was because he was the owner of the company, a power differential, but his success came from his soft voice.
So she explained one technique from her grandfather's mentor. So we're going to go now. We're going to ask you to do something like we've done before. Your mission, if you choose to accept it, is to experience the next 24 hours, one full day, by keeping the space between you and others safe. We call this a principle. The application is to refrain from any verbal unsolicited opinions during every conversation. So let's address this real quick.
Yeah, let's break this idea of principle versus application. So the principle you're saying is that safe space, there's a principle out there that safe space needs to be there for yourself and for others. And it wasn't happening when Buck was trying to do his management job, clearly. He's now going to try a new, taking that safe space principle that Jillian's kind of introduced to him, an application.
So the difference between principle and application is this. So going back to Connect or Hardwired to Connect, one of the most powerful and important secrets to making friends and connecting with others is learning how to live a principle-based life. So what principles do you want to align yourself with and how to apply the principles? The difference that we have is that most people don't, they confuse the difference between a principle and an application, or what I call a principle and a rule. Too often, homes or organizations that have tons of rules are homes and organizations that have low trust. They don't have good connections because there's a rule for everything.
Like explicit rules.
Don't do, or you have to do, you have to do.
Right.
So it isn't that rules are bad. It isn't that rules are good. It's that if there isn't a principle associated with said rules, if there isn't a principle associated with them, there's going to be confusion. So one of the examples I use is love. Okay. According to Christian beliefs, love makes the world go round. Love your neighbor as thyself. Love your God. All right, let's argue for a moment that love is a principle. How do you apply it? What's the application of love? And that, it's rhetorical. So the idea here is, in my rules of engagement, my principle is create safe space for others. The application of that principle is refrain from. Well, what are we refraining from? In this particular one, refraining from unsolicited opinions. Refraining from criticism, sarcasm, judging, and relating. Well, what happens if you refrain from? So now let's look at the results of the application of the principle of safe space. Imagine for a second, if you're listening to this, that you spend the next 25 minutes talking to someone that you've never met before, but who in that 25 minutes only asks personal questions about you without the slightest hint of a judgment. They don't relate to anything you're saying from the standpoint of, oh, yeah, I know what you're going through. Oh, yeah, I've done the same thing. None of that. They simply ask questions based on your answer that helps you go deeper. So this last week, I was interviewed by two gentlemen. I think they were out of Wisconsin on a product that I just picked up for my banking. They wanted to know why I chose a particular business bank that I'm doing business with. And it was supposed to go for an hour. And I told them I have limited time, but that
was like a marketing survey.
It was.
Mm-hmm.
Now, keep in mind, I make a living sitting in this chair, talking to people about them, asking tons of questions about them. In this particular 45-minute segment, they asked questions about me, my decision-making process, my business, why I did this. I'll give an answer and they'll go back and ask more questions. And it was two of them. And they were having a riot because I tell them stories as to why I would do things. And they were going, oh, this is so much fun, Richard. Thanks a lot. And then ask me another question. said, we have more out of this information than we have out of most. And that was maybe just a compliment, whether it was true or not, I don't know. But I got to tell you, Sherry, for 45 minutes, I got to tell them about me.
And it was a survey.
It was just about me.
Isn't that interesting?
Not once did they say, oh, yeah, we do the same thing. Once did they do that.
And how did it feel?
Oh, heaven. It was so fun. I rarely get people who ask me questions, right? And I'm not looking for someone to do that. You're good at that.
So coming back to Buck and what he's going to do with this challenge of not offering unsolicited opinions for 24 hours, his awareness is going to change. And hopefully he can see that, in a sense, by surveying that same experience, the neutral questions to his team, like he can return back to getting useful information that he can make and lead a team by.
Well, how did he used to do it? He used to sit at the whiteboard. They have one member of the team just write all the ideas, and Buck would ask questions.
Because he was one of them. But he can also do that as a leader in a lot of different respects to be able to lead the team by. And that will empower him as a leader. But not only will it make the team feel like, okay, now I have a voice. And you had a voice by simply taking a survey where a human body was listening.
So,
this is fascinating.
So go back to the principle. Principle is safe space. I'd argue that's part of love, but that's a different conversation. So if the principle is safe space, the other principle in my rules of engagement is empathy. In other words, listening to understand. That's the principle. What's the application of empathy? What would an application be of? Remember, empathy means to understand the thoughts and the feelings of another human being through their eyes without personal bias. This has been a challenge for a lot of people.
So that means the application is to listen and to give power to the person who's speaking.
And how do you give power?
By asking them questions that lead them to go deeper or broader in their subject.
And I'll add on top of that, one of the applications is no unsolicited stuff from you.
Yes, yeah, so you can't be doing one and the other. It displaces the other. And that's what's going to happen with Buck as he applies this. So one of the things that I find so interesting as a teacher, but to apply in relationships, is to elicit student understanding. If you just elicit your friend's understanding, how are you possibly going to do that if you're inserting your opinion?
We have become normed to not only be around people who are always inserting their opinions, but we think that's what we need to do. Remember, we're hardwired to connect. I'm going back to that again. When we don't connect, we'll medicate. Have you ever considered that all of the opinions you're throwing out, the judging, the relating, going to Facebook and watching all the negative responses, with all due respect, they're medicating. That anger that's manifested in Facebook because they don't agree with your post, how many of them are really just trying to understand your position? Why did you do it? What were your motives? What were your intent? One of the myths we have today is that it doesn't matter what intent is, it's how I interpret it.
And that's the whole point, is that they're not seeking for understanding. England has just done a really interesting study on tweets, and they've studied outrage or rage as a habit, but it's really an addiction is what they're saying. Is like it's an uncontrolled habit, which is an addiction.
They're not saying it's an addiction. We are classifying
right.
It as an addiction.
It's just a matter of semantics and terms, but that they have identified that in tweeting and Twitter, social media, that rage has become an addiction. People are going to social media because they have to get juiced by seeing negative comments.
Exactly right. So I remember when I was writing for the paper, back when there was a newspaper, they put it all online. I didn't know it was online, so I went once to look at it, and an article I had written 1 year earlier was posted and had like 5 or 6 comments. The first 3 were angry at me, chewing me out, saying the author doesn't even have the balls to come on and defend himself. Thinking, one, I didn't even know I was being attacked. And the thing you're attacking me for, you don't even understand the context in which I presented it.
And the other interesting thing is in those like online tweets or social media, or whatever, you would never use that language to someone's face.
No.
That's the thing, is that people use a language. They're using a context that
it's like putting a mask on.
Inflammatory. Yes. And so it's way inflamed.
And you're right. And we're going to end on this one. when you need to go online and make a comment about someone out of anger and tell them that they're wrong and be disagreeable, how much of that is just to get your drugs because you're not happy with your own relationships because you don't like yourself, because you're telling yourself a story that's not true? In Buck's scenario and in the one we did earlier about the one at home, both scenarios are such they have to be right. They are telling themselves stories that aren't true. And to find happiness, to find connectivity with others, learn the principles that make you happy.
So it's so interesting that the principle of safe space has the application of unsolicited opinions. And it is the antithesis of what we see in social media.
That's right. So everybody, thanks for listening. This has been delightful. We look forward to putting this on the HimmerInstitute.com as part of the course.
Join the courses. Take them. Give us some reflection. There's spots where you can journal, where you can add comments. We want to hear from you.
Thanks, everyone. Talk to you soon.
Doubt is a broken record that plays inside my head. I try to turn it down, but I can't quite drown it out. I'm tortured every day. These never-ending wars.